So yeah, thanks for the introduction, Shri Kumar sir, and thanks to Honeycomb for this nice opportunity. It's indeed
Thank
a
you.
great learning thing for everyone in this pandemic time. So it's good to have all of you around. So I'll be starting the introduction about Lightroom, and we'll of how to use this. So before I begin the process of using Lightroom, let me give you a brief introduction about Lightroom. Can I ask everyone to please mute their audio? I'm getting some background noises actually. So, as you all know, Adobe Lightroom is a software that is built for photographers to edit their images. Lightroom was started in 2007, and the interesting fact is it was started by a group of photographers. So this is the tool that people with passion to photography have built the product to photographers. So from 2007, like almost 13 years later on, there are many different clients, different products from Lightroom through various clients like mobile and web applications. So the initial Lightroom that we all know was designed 13 years back. Now you may ask, there was already Photoshop, then why Lightroom? So Photoshop was, I think Photoshop was there from 25 to 30 years or so. So there are two things. One is Photoshop is a software that is made for creative professionals. That is people who, you know, like make brochures and make adjustments with their images, add layers and all such things. For all the creative content people, Photoshop is the software, and Lightroom is a software meant for photographers. So all the fine adjustments that you need to enhance your image is like, you know, done through Lightroom. So yeah, that is one thing. And second thing is, Photoshop is a tool that is meant for destructive editing, and Lightroom is for non-destructive editing. I'll explain you what is destructive and non-destructive. And don't get carried away by the term destructive editing and stop using Photoshop, because Photoshop itself has its own set of clients. So yeah, so this is the brief history or background on how Lightroom was created. Next. So this presentation is in association with all these wonderful people. So thanks to all of them.
Arjun, sorry to interrupt.
Yeah.
Can you be a little more audible? I think I'm just getting.
Is it? Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Is it better now?
Yes, it is.
Sure.
Thank you.
Oh, okay. So should I repeat from first, or is it fine?
It is fine. You may proceed. Yeah.
Okay. So thanks to all these wonderful people, Honeycomb, Photostop, X-Rite, and Srishti Digital. Next, going on. Okay, so what I believe is Lightroom is a journey from taking an image to making an image. The above image that you see is as short, and you can see how much power Lightroom has to make it look like how it is below. Right. So this is a 10 image panorama that I shot in Yosemite National Park in the US. And this is the famous tunnel view viewpoint. Okay. So as I said before, so initially Lightroom was started as a single application, which is meant only in desktop. And now Lightroom has a wide variety of applications. So we have Lightroom on the web. So you can just enter a URL and you can access Lightroom. So you have Lightroom on the desktop, where there are two applications, Lightroom Classic and Lightroom CC. And you have two applications on the mobile side as well. One is for Android and one is for iOS. So I'll explain you how we can interact with all these three clients with just a single click of a button in going forward. So Lightroom desktop has two variants. One is Lightroom Classic CC and Lightroom CC that I've told before. Mobile has these applications, and one for the Android and one for iOS. And with knowing all these, let's see how you can actually download them. So there is a suite called, there is an application called Adobe Creative Cloud. So where you have variety of applications like Photoshop, Bridge, Lightroom, whatnot. You have like everything in this particular suite and you can download whichever software you need. So just Google Adobe Creative Cloud and you can install this, and from there you can download applications like Classic and Photoshop. So the desktop, only the desktop applications can be downloaded from the desktop Adobe Creative Cloud applications. So on the mobile, you can get it on Play Store and App Store. And the web, you need not download anywhere. You can just go to this URL and you can access your images and you can edit on the go. Only thing that is required is the internet connection. So if there is no internet connection, basically the URL doesn't work and you cannot use Lightroom web. So Lightroom that you all knew all these years is now renamed as Lightroom Classic. Okay, so all these years, past 13 years or so, whatever we called it as Lightroom has been renamed to Lightroom Classic. And there is a new desktop based web application, cloud based application called Lightroom CC. So whenever you go to this particular screen, right, in Adobe Creative Cloud, so you get two options called Lightroom and Lightroom Classic. So what I'll be explaining you today is the pure traditional Lightroom, which is now renamed as Lightroom Classic. So this particular, the below one that you see, I'll be explaining more on that. So Lightroom also you can try out, which is mostly a cloud-based application. But yeah, for today, we'll see Lightroom Classic. So this would be the basic workflow for every photographer. So right from capturing, so this is the basic step. So you capture your images, then you try to get it into the software, be it any software. I'm just giving an idea. So you import the images, then you edit and export. But in Lightroom, there is an additional powerful feature to organize your images, which I'll explain you in a minute. So this is the basic workflow. You capture, you import, you organize, you develop, and then you export, right? So I'll go through all these steps in some time. So before that, we need to know what is a catalog. So Lightroom Classic is a catalog-based photo editing application. So catalog is nothing but, it is a database. So it is a database which has all your entries for the images. I'll give you a layman's example. Say you go to a library, right? So you have a index register with the receptionist. So if you open the index register, you see which book is present in which particular shelf. For example, say you want a book on photography, it would be in some shelf. If you want a book on science, it would be in some shelf. Like that, Lightroom catalog also has maintains these entries. Like this image is from which location, what are the edits that are present in this image. It doesn't contain the image as such, but it contains only the information pertaining to the image. So this is the basic fundamental thing that you need to have when you install Lightroom Classic. Next, these are the important modules that are available in Lightroom. So the library, develop, map, book, slideshow, print, and web. So I might not be able to explain all the modules, but I would be explaining the library and develop module, which is the most commonly used modules and the most powerful modules. So there are other modules also, like these map, book, slideshow, and all. So these things you can, you can get it, you can get a lot of tutorials on it, but the library and develop modules are the basic crux engine of whatever you say, the editing part, right? Okay, so when you open Lightroom, so I'll also give a demo in Lightroom as well going forward. But these are the basic slides that I'll be showing you before I proceed to demonstrating how Lightroom works. So when you import an image in library module, say it looks like this. So you have all the controls like what to do with that image. So that is called as organizing, which I'll be explaining. Now, getting photos into Lightroom is called as import. So if you want to bring your photos to Lightroom. So bring your photos into Lightroom, meaning your photos are still present in your virtual whatever drive, your pen drive, external hard drive, it is still there. It is just that Lightroom is referencing to those images with the help of the catalog that I explained to you before. Right. So you are getting light images into Lightroom. So this process is called as import. So all the different formats of images are supported through Lightroom, all the raw images and the various JPEG TIFFs and the PNGs, everything. Alternatively, you can also import video files like AVI, MOV, MP4, all these things. But Lightroom is only a photo editing software, but you can also import videos just for like if you want to create a slideshow or some things, so it is still supported, but you cannot do high-end editing on videos. So getting images to Lightroom is called, one part of it is called as import. Second thing is called as tethering images. So what is tethering images is, say this is very much useful for all the portrait photographers or the studio photographers. So it is like the general process is you ask people to pose for you, you click images, you then remove the SD card, then get it to Lightroom, and then you import images. This is a standard procedure. But through tethering images, what you can do is you can directly connect your camera to Lightroom. Then with this file, I've given the path here. So when you go to file, tethered capture, and start tethered capture, Lightroom will automatically recognize your camera. Then it will allow you to click the camera. So Lightroom will take control of your camera. You can adjust aperture, shutter speed, ISO, whatever you want through Lightroom itself. And you can also, there is a click button in Lightroom that you can click so that the image captures through the camera and automatically is imported to Lightroom. So this is a very big step that can be avoided, like if you do it manually. So this is also one process of getting images to Lightroom. But yeah, but tethering images, you need to have the cable and all these things attached with the camera through the software. And you need to compose properly so that your focusing doesn't change and all these things. Then you can download to Lightroom. So I'll be explaining the different views, what you see in Lightroom. So this is like when you import an image, you see such things. So you can have checklists of what items you want to import, what you want to exclude from the import process. So this is called as the import grid view. So this is the Lightroom workspace. These are the important shortcuts that you need to be aware of. So I'll show you in the tool also. But it's better to always work with shortcuts so that it's a very easy process. So yeah. So in the library module, we have different views. One is called the grid view, one is called the loop view, compare view, and survey view. The thing that you are seeing in loop view, the thing that you are seeing currently in the screen is called as grid view. Grid view is nothing but the grid images or the thumbnails that you can see in your screen. So this can be seen in library module. So whatever I'm explaining currently is solely based on library module. So these are the different panels. The above panel is called as a navigation panel. The below panel is called as a film strip. The left panel where you can see your navigation previews, all photograph counts and all these things. The right side is where you can make controls or edit basic edits to the image. So in Lightroom, you can do basic editing through library module, which you can see in the right panel of your screen in the quick develop section. So the exposure basic controls such as exposure, white balance, clarity, vibrance, all these things can be done through Lightroom library module itself. If you want advanced editing, you can just switch over to the develop module, which I'll be showing you in a bit. But yeah, when I going forward, when I say film strip or grid view, you should be able to relate that, okay, how it looks like. So the grid view looks like this, the film strip looks like this. So that's the reason I'm giving you the basic introduction. Okay. So another thing is when you import images, there is something called a smart preview. So smart preview is one amazing technology that is introduced in Lightroom, where you can work with images even if the image is not physically present with you. So what I mean to say is, say suppose you are traveling and you have your external hard disk with images. Now, as I said, catalog references to your image that is present in your catalog, that is present in your hard disk. Say if your hard disk is not there with you, so the image is not referenced to your catalog. In this case, you are not allowed to work on the image. But smart preview, what you can do is when you import image and you convert it to a smart preview, it builds a small file inside the catalog itself where it contains, it references to that file basically. So you can start working with your image until you connect back your hard disk or the image wherever it is present. So until then, you can work with the image. You can allow Lightroom to work on it without having the physical original image also. So this adds up to your storage, but the benefit is that you can use whenever you want, even if the image is not there. So as I explained earlier, these are the different views. The first one was the grid view, and the shortcut key is G. Remember the shortcut key G. It is like you can switch from any modules to Lightroom's grid view by just pressing the shortcut G. Okay. So this is called the cell, whatever we saw in grid view, all right? So this is the individual cell or the individual thumbnail of the image. So this has different metadata is nothing but basic information which is used to organize your image. So the different metadata can be like your flagging, your stars. That is like, say you have shot hundreds of images and you want to select the best ones. So you can rate those images, just like how you rate movies, 3-star, 2-star, 5-star. You can rate your images also. This process also I would be explaining in some time. Then the single image view in library is called as loop view. So till now, whatever you saw, the multiple image view in library module was the grid view, and the single image view is called as library view. So this is basically you can use to, you know, select your image. Say if you have shot multiple images and you want to know which is the best one. So the single image, you can select a single image, zoom in, zoom out, check the sharpness of it. And if you want, you can discard it or you can retain it. The next thing would be the survey view. Survey view is like you can select any number of images, and those number of images would only be shown in your screen. And you can, again, this is also a process of refining your images or organizing your images. Next thing would be compare view, where you can compare between two images only. You can zoom in, zoom out, do whatever. This is also like, say I have two images of sunbird here. I want to know which one is the sharpest to retain it and discard the other one. So what I can do, I can just select these two images in compare view, go zoom through it, check the sharpness. If it is according to my satisfaction, I can pick the image. Now I will show you how this works in Lightroom. My Lightroom can be seen, right?
Yes.
Okay. Say whatever you are seeing here is the grid view that I've explained earlier, right? Now, if you press E on an image, that takes you to loop view. Say on this image, I press E. The shortcut is E, which will take you to loop view. Loop view is nothing but the...
We are not able to see it actually.
Is it?
Compare view.
Oh, that is my... Okay, that was my PowerPoint, I think. Okay, 1 second. not able to see my Lightroom now also?
No, we are seeing the compare view.
Okay, that is the PowerPoint actually. That's the slideshow. I mean, that's my PowerPoint presentation.
You will have to minimize the screen and go to your live screen.
Yeah, I've done that already. Okay, I think now you can see, right? I think now you can see.
Yeah, now yes. We can. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, so the things that I explained earlier was grid view, compare view, grid view, loop view, compare view, and survey mode. So these are the things that are there in library module. So the starting thing is grid view. So here, as I explained, so this is the images that you can see all together. Alternatively, you can go to view, select grid, or loop, or compare, or survey. The shortcut key is G. Now, if you want to, okay, I have these many images. Now, if you want to just single out a particular image, go to loop view, say press E. So once you press E, it becomes a single image. Now you can check the image by zooming in, zooming out, check the clarity of it. And if at all you need, you can retain it or you can discard it. The next thing would be, there are three options to go into such modes. One is the shortcut G. One is go to view, select loop. Third thing is this bar. Can you see my cursor down below, just above the film strip? So
yes.
Yeah. So this is grid view. This takes you to grid view. This takes you to loop view. So you have all these three options and you can select whichever you want. So the next thing would be compare view. Say I compare between two images. Now, if I want to know which is the better one that I have to retain and which one I can, discard. So this view also helps you to organize your images. So you can zoom in, zoom out, check a particular area, which one is fine. Then you can ideally pick it or give a 5-star rating to that image. So alternatively, so this bar, right? So this is the star panel where you rate your images. So clicking in the last point would give you a 5-star image, or you can also, shortcut key would be number 5, right? So one is this, other one is pick or reject. So the small flag icons that you can see on the left of the image, say you just click the first one, it is P. If you click the next one, it is reject. So the shortcut would be P for picking. The shortcut for rejecting would be X. So please make a note of all these shortcuts, which would be very helpful in the future. Also, you can go to help mode, and here you have a Lightroom module shortcuts. So once you press this, you get all the shortcuts that are available for library module. So whichever module you are in, you just go to that module, go to help and library module shortcuts. You can see all the shortcuts and you can easily work on it. So this is all about compare view. The next thing would be survey module. So in survey mode, what happens is you can have multiple images at a time. So you can compare between all these images and then you can take call on it. So the shortcut would be N. So if you hover on it also, it gives a small tip saying what mode is it and what is the shortcut for that particular mode. Since I'm already in survey mode, it doesn't give the tooltip. But now if you just hover on it, ideally it gives the tooltip with the shortcut key. Okay. So this is all about how you view your images in Lightroom. Okay. So next would be next is organizing your images. So this is the most important aspect of any photographer. Say you have shot hundreds of images in a particular session of photography, and now all these days, what people used to do in Photoshop, or Photoshop is basically you open one image, you see, come out, edit, and all these things, right? So in Lightroom, you can import all images at once, check the best images, reject the rest. So this is a very good way to save your hard disk space, save your location, I mean, save your hard disk space, and also check the best images from your collection. So organizing photos, how you filter your photos. So along with image editing, the other best thing of Lightroom, as I said, is filtering photos. So in filtering photos, as you can see, you can filter based on the text or the attributes or the metadata. So in text, you can filter based on your file name or title, caption, keywords, whatever. Attributes, as I showed you, you can filter based on your pick, reject, flag status, your rating status, your color labels. Metadata also, you can filter based on Lightroom. As I said, see, all the images contain your lens module, lens information, camera information, date information, capture date, everything is stored in the catalog. So Lightroom has a list of all this information. So basically, you just select which information you want and Lightroom will give you all the photos shot in that particular time frame. Right. So let me show you how this works in Lightroom. See, I'm in grid view. I have all these images. Now I say I like this image. I'll give a pick rating for it. Pick rating shortcut key is P. I give it P. I pick this. I didn't like this image, so I rejected it. I like this image, I picked it. This one, I picked it. So basically, I have 4 picks, 2 rejects, right? So now if you want Lightroom to show, give me only the picked images. So go to your grid view. In grid view, you can see in the top library filter, you have text, attribute, metadata. So go to your attribute section, just say, show me the picked ones. Say it gives all the picked ones. This is how you can filter your images. Now you want to delete all the rejected ones. So you just say, after you have done your rejection, just go to your library filter, say attribute, click on reject flag. So you get these two rejected. That means you don't want any longer in your system. Then you can delete it. So when you delete it, it asks you whether you have to delete only from Lightroom catalog. That means Lightroom catalog just dereferences your images from your whatever location, or you want to delete it permanently. So there can be two ways. It can be like you just don't need the image only in your Lightroom, but you need it in your physical hardware, or you don't need the image at all. So you can do a delete from disk that will delete the image permanently. Ideally, it will put it in the trash and you will have to delete it from there. So this is one way of filtering your images. Now, another way, as I said, there are star ratings. Same way how you rate your movies. Say selecting all is command A, shortcut is command A. So now in this image, I like this image very much. So I give it a 5-star rating. So shortcut key would be 5, or alternatively, any of these dots that you see. So I click on the third one, it gives only the 3-star. If you click on the fourth one, it gives only 4 stars. Right. So I like this one, I give it a 5-star. I like this one, I give it a 5-star. I didn't like this much, so I'll give it a 1-star. So similarly, this one, I give it a 1-star. Now you want to reject all the images with 1-star. So you just go to the attribute panel, just click on 1-star. So this rating is greater than equal to 1-star. So all these images are selected. So if you say Lightroom rating is equal to 1-star, it gives only the images that is 1-star. So you have all these special combinations that you can use to filter out images. Like rating would be greater than 1-star, equal to 1-star, less than equal to, all these. Next thing would be metadata. So these are all important steps in organizing, as I said. So next thing would be metadata. So here metadata also, I can filter based on the year that I have shot. So in 2015, October, all the images that I've shot in 2015 October would be shown here. Similarly, all the images that I've shot in 2016 will be shown here. So this is another way of organizing. You can also organize based on the camera models. This camera model would be based only on the camera models of the images imported. So you can also filter based on the lens selections. And there is another thing called as labels. So this is called as color labels. Say color labels are important when you are editing an image. Say, suppose I have started to edit this image. So I would generally give it a red status. That means I have not yet started editing image. So these color labels, all these conventions are just made according to you. So it is not like there is no hard and fast rule that you have to use this color label or that anything. So it is just according to your convenience. Say this image, I am a wedding photographer, for example, and I have started working on my client's photos, and I have to start working on these images, and I know that I have not edited this image. So I give it a rating as, I give a color label as red star. Then once I start editing, probably just for my convenience, I'll change the label to yellow. That means work in progress, for example. Once it is almost ready, once it is completely ready for me to delivering it to my clients or they can publish. So I would change it to green status. So green means it's completely, this is according to my convention. So it can vary upon yours. So green for me would be it's ready to use or ready to deliver. So once it is green, probably I can again select based on my label. So this is again, I filter based on my color label. So based on green, so I've selected green. I got only this image since other all images were not flagged. So now I, as such, I can have all these multiple images that are there with green label, and I can directly give it to them. So this is how you organize your images. Alternatively, you can also organize your images from what we call as collections. In olden days, we had albums, right? The physical albums where we used to store photos of a particular trip. Say you go to Himalayas, you get make the images in a, print those images, put it in an album. Again, take a next album, you put somewhere else. Similarly, we have something called as collections in Lightroom. So where you can have all the images of a particular place in one collection. As such, it's again according to your convention. Third thing would be to store in folders. So based on folders also, you can directly, you know, access those images. So these are the various ways where you can organize your images. Right. So any doubt till now, or shall I continue further?
Hey Arjun, Rahul here. I just wanted to understand how you get this grid, like navigator, library filter and all, from where to activate that.
I didn't get you. So where we get the library filter, is it?
No. Now I can see on your screen, it written library filter, text, attribute, metadata, none. So how do you activate this screen access? So from where you have activated?
This you have to go to the grid view. So in the grid view, you get this in grid view.
Okay, grid view then?
You're in grid view, but you're not able to see the text attribute and all these things, right? So then say show filter bar, which is in the view menu, show filter bar. So once you click on this, it will be shown.
Sure. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Okay. So, so this is how you organize your images. So going on. Basically you can organize, as I said, based on folders, collections, smart collections, anything. Right. So this is all about library module. So
Arjun, sorry to interrupt. This, this thing by folders and all that, collections, folders and all that, they're in Lightroom or they're in your laptop?
So what you are seeing in my, 1 second, I'll show my Lightroom screen itself. So you're talking about the left panel ones, right?
Yeah.
So see, that's what, as I told, Lightroom catalog is just referencing the information that is present on the images. Now, all these images, all these folders are there in my laptop. Okay. So this information, this folder's information, the folder name, whatever, is getting referenced through the catalog. So that's the reason, whatever folders that you're seeing, this is in my laptop. This is also seen in my Lightroom.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so so what we saw was the different views in library module and how you can organize your images through the different mechanisms that we have to flag the images. Now let us go to the next module that is called as develop module. So before develop module, we have this thing called as Adobe Camera Raw. I think most of you would have heard it. So this is the most powerful raw engine that we have, and Photoshop and Lightroom, everything uses this particular thing. So whatever you see, whatever happens in develop module is the internal background soul of it is Adobe Camera Raw. So even if you open a raw image in your Photoshop, so the initial thing that you see, right? So that is not Photoshop, that is the Camera Raw that opens. So Camera Raw contains all these edit functionalities that is there in modern day Lightroom. So once you open Lightroom, once you open develop module, you see something like this. Okay. So this is basically, so from library, let's shift to develop module. Okay. So once you open develop module, you can see all these panels. So the same thing still applies, all the four different panels, the top navigation panel, the right panel, the bottom panel known as film strip, and the left panel. So this is the navigator image. You can zoom in, zoom out on the images. Fit view would be fitting to your screen. Then 1:1. You can zoom according to the ratios, right?
And sorry, you're still in that.
Sorry for that. Okay, yeah. So now, so this is my develop screen. Right. So this is how the basic develop module looks like. So that all the four panels are still the same here also. The navigation panel, the right panel where you make edits, the bottom panel or the film strip panel, and the left panel where all these presets and all these things are stored. So I'll explain you all of them in a bit. So the first thing that you see is the navigator image that shows which image is activated currently. So when you change the image, that it changes to the next image, right? So here you can change your zoom ratios, fill 1:1, 2:1. You can even zoom further, 3:1. There is a small drop down icon next to the 2:1 button. So if you click on it, you can zoom through different ratios. If you don't want anything, the maximum view would be 1:1. That is like 100% view. But to fit on your screen, just click on the fit view. So it will just fit on your screen. So the next thing would be histogram. So here you can see how evenly the images captured, how evenly the exposure is there. Based on that, you can start editing your images. So your exposure also shows all these different settings on what parameters was the image shot. Okay. So the next thing would be the information. We call this as information of an image. So the shortcut key would be pressing I for India. So when you press I, currently, see, as you can see on my image, I can know that this image's file name is holidaylights.cr2. That means it's captured from a Canon camera. Shutter speed is 5 seconds at f13, aperture and ISO is 200. This was captured at 15mm fisheye lens. Now, if you don't want this information, which if it is distracting you, just press I, it will go away. Right. So this is how it works, and again pressing I would recycle you to the different information, that is when it was captured, what is the resolution of that particular image. So this is the information of an image. Now there are basic things called as above the basic panel that you see, this is called as a basic. So above thing what you see is called as local adjustments. So the first important thing is crop module. So crop, everyone would know what is crop. So basically, if you want to just limit your frame to a particular content, particular area, just crop on it. I mean, just select that area so that image is selected. Only that part of that image is selected. So I think crop is the most famous tool available across various applications, and people would be aware of how it works. Second thing would be spot removal. I have examples for each one of them. I'll explain you how it works in detail. So this is like, I'm just giving you a gist of it, like what all is available in the image. Okay, now this is the crop module. The shortcut key would be R. So say you have if you just hover over that particular icon, it gives you what that particular icon means and what is the shortcut key to access that particular functionality. So this is the spot removal. Spot removal is like you remove unwanted regions in your image. I'll show you how it works. And this is the red eye correction. So red eye, like if you have shot night with flash on the eye, because of the ranging differences of the intensity, sometimes there are chances that the eyeball becomes red in color. So this particular tool will help you to isolate that particular problem. Next is the gradient filter. So gradient filter is like you just drag on the image. So that particular area would be selected and you can just make adjustments only to that area. Right? See, only that area is changing and not any other areas. So this is called a gradial filter. Next thing is called as radial filter. Radial filter is, and yeah, the shortcut key for this is M. Letter M, and shortcut key for this is Shift and M, radial filter. So radial filter, what it does is say, suppose I want only this gate to be highlighted, right? See, only the gate is highlighted, not any other things. Now, if you want to inverse it, so you have selected the gate and you don't want the gate to be edited, but you want the outer areas of the selection to be edited, just click on the small checkbox called invert. So when you click on invert, it selects the outer area. So you can just select or edit the remaining areas apart from the selection. So this is radial filter. So our next thing would be brush. So you can also brush on the desired areas so that you can get the effect only on that particular area. So this is called as brush, adjustment brush. And there are something called as pins actually. So if you say you have on this image, you have multiple selections, multiple brushes, and you want to know which brush to use. So when you select this brush, you get something called as pins, right? So when you click on this pin, only that particular area is highlighted. So you can either remove it or you can make further adjustments to those areas. So this is called as local adjustments. All these things are called as local adjustments. These are global adjustments. So what do we mean by local adjustment and global adjustment is, say, the basic panel, whatever we see is a global adjustment. That means whatever change you make, that affects the whole image. See, it affects the whole image. Whereas local adjustment, it affects only that particular area in an image. Only this particular area is affected. So sometimes there are chances that you need to enhance only a particular portion of an image. In that case, you make use of these tools. So then we have the basic panel where we have all the white balance. Say if your white balance is off or because of the setting, you need not worry if you have shot in RAW. So there is this white balance panel where you can change the temperature of the image from cool to warm. And you can also change the tint of an image from greenish to magenta. Also, if you are not sure, say in this example, also if you are not sure what white balance to use. So if in white balance, there are different options. So these options you get only on RAW images. All the auto, daylight, cloudy, all these information you get only on RAW images. As you can see, my image, this particular image is a CR2 image that is seen below, right? So that means it's a RAW image, hence I'm getting all this information. So there is this thing called as picker, white balance picker icon. So if you are not sure what white balance to give, just take this picker icon and click on any of the area that you want. See, it changes your white balance accordingly. So on that particular white balance, so the best thing suggested is click on any gray area. So it automatically gives you proper white balance according to the scene of that image. And if you are not interested, if you are not happy with whatever the software is giving, you can still further make further adjustments using these sliders. So this is your white balance. Next things are like how you change your exposure, contrast, highlight, shadows. So you want to brighten up the image completely, make use of your exposure, or if you want to if you want to underexpose the image, make use of your exposure towards the negative side. So you have this option till 5 points. So basically you can go till 5 points. So similarly, you have contrast highlights and all these things. So based on all these controls, you can make even more finer adjustments based on the setting. Say you have highlights. So if at all a very bright area in your image, which doesn't have any details, the details are lost because of the brightness of that particular region. So make use of highlight slider so that the details is like, you know, you get details even in the brightest regions. Similarly, I'll show you some example for it. Okay, so this image. Say this image, as shot it is very dark. So you want it to be more bright. So just bring out the exposure. Okay. So once you bring out the exposure, you get it. You can brighten up the areas. You can, but this will brighten up everything. So to brighten up everything. But if you want selective brightening only on particular areas, as I said, you can use the local adjustment tools. Again, so these areas also. See the sky here. This point, wherever my cursor is, where the sun is setting. See, if you can see, there are no details at all. Details are overpowered by the brightness of that particular region. So if you reduce the highlight, see how magically Lightroom gets back all those details to you. So this is how details are used. Similarly, if in the dark regions, if there are no details, you can pull up your shadows so that that particular regions are, you can get details on those regions. So if you can see, all the buildings in the distant horizon here doesn't have details because my shadows is less. So if you bring up shadows, see how you can get details on those particular areas. So this is how details are used, right? So next thing would be, whites and blacks. So these are like independent controls that you have to refine your images based on different parameters of contrast and lights. So whites would be like the brightest part of the image. If you want to control the brightest part, you put on whites. If you want to control the darkest parts, you control blacks, similarly. So texture clarity to give you more punch in the image or to give some HDR-ish look or to It basically controls the contrast regions of all the mid-tone areas. Mid-tones are nothing but, so if you can see, right? So in the image, if there are shadows, the middle ranges between shadows and highlights would be your mid-tones. So all the regions that are there in the middle are being controlled by all these sliders, texture clarity. So it just affects those sliders. Next thing would be tone curve. Say you are not satisfied with the controls here, you can make refine adjustments with your tone curve functionality. So tone curve is basically, there is a curve, you can ideally push it, pull it, whatever you do, you can. So this area, see, it is the top right area would be your highlight region, that is the bright regions. Say if I make control C, only the sky part is getting changed. That means only that area has highlights. So it is only affecting that region. If I do the bottom ones, see only the darker areas are getting affected. That means these are the regions in shadows and only those things are getting affected. And you can also apply on midtones where it applies evenly on all the middle areas. Okay. So this is how tone curve works. Similarly, there are like very good tutorials available for all particular models, all particular panels, if at all you need in depth. These are just icing through the surface. So you can individually change colors of a particular region based on your hue, saturation, lamination, hue, saturation, luminance controls, change the intensity of a particular region, do all these stuff. So then split toning also, you can change the saturation of the highlight regions. So you want to get it more sunset-ish kind of look. So just you can play around with these areas. So just with a click of a small changes, you can change the image drastically. So this is where you can use Pinktoni. Then the famous thing is, how do I make my images look sharp? So we have something called as detail panel just below your split toning. So here we have this sharpness panel, sharpness slider, where you can increase or decrease based on your required satisfaction. So one tip that I would give here is, for example, say you are editing this image. This is an image of a robber fly with prey. So say you are adjusting sharpness of this image. You want only the robber fly, only the subject to be in sharp and not any of the background or whatever. So what you can do is, there is something called as masking. Say you set this sharpness to your required, whatever slider required. Then there is this masking. Just hold the option key or alt key, option key in Mac and alt key in Windows. When you click on the option key and click on this dropper icon, so the image becomes like this. Image becomes white, and when you start dragging, the image looks like this. So whatever white regions you are seeing in the image, only that region will be applied for sharpening. So in this case, only the subject and the grass blade that is visible is getting applied. So for other background images, say you have some dust spots or something, those things won't be affected by your sharpening. So this is a very good tool for macro photographers or anybody who wants to have a detailed control only on the subject, right? So the shortcut key would be holding alt key, then change the masking slider. So wherever it is white, the black areas are not affected at all. Only the white areas are affected in the image. So lens correction, I have very good examples for all these, which I'll be explaining in a minute. Lens correction. I showed you this image sometime back, which we were just editing. Say you have gone to a party and a friend gives you a camera and asks you to shoot, and you shoot all the images and you give it back to him. Then you realize, this image was shot in a different lens which was not intended for using. So in this case, this image was shot through a fisheye lens. So as you can see, the distortion amount is like huge, because that is how it is designed for. However, if you do not like the distortion level of this particular lens and you want to change it, now you cannot reshoot the scene because it's already over. So Lightroom has this functionality called lens corrections. So in lens correction, with just a single click of a button, you can remove the distortion of the image. See, in this case, the fence is totally curved, the trees are curved, and all these things are curved. With just single click of a button, you can just remove all the curve and make it a straight image. So there is, when you open lens correction panel, you have something called as remove chromatic aberration and enable profile corrections. So when you click on enable profile corrections, see the magic. Just one click of a button, how it was, how it is now. So this, how it happens is, we have individual lens profiles for all the various cameras that are available. So you can select whatever lens that is there. So Lightroom automatically selects the best lens profile that was shot. So then it applies the correction. However, if you're not satisfied, you can again, you can change your lens profiles. You can select other lenses, so it will give desired results according to that lens. Say if it was shot with this lens, how it would have looked and all those things. So this is basically, it corrects those particular, whatever thing was like could not be corrected before can be corrected now, right? So with just a single click of a button, you just, it will give you the best results. So this is how lens correction works. Similarly, there is one more thing called as chromatic aberration. So this is also achieved when you have shot the image in the camera itself and you cannot correct it. So there are a lot of physics that is involved in it, like how the fringing happens and because of the different wavelengths and all those things. Let me not go much in detail about it. So I'll show you how to correct those glitches that is caused while shooting. Say I have this image. Right. Let me just go. Let me just zoom. So generally, chromatic aberration is caused whenever there is a sudden change between your brightest and the darkest points. So in such scenarios, there is some small color fringing that happens across the border of the image. In this case, you can see this light blue haloish effect that is seen on the rocks, right? So this is nothing but a chromatic aberration. So if you want to remove it, it is like, if at all there was no option to remove the chromatic aberration, what you used to do, you used to take this brush, apply on all the thing and desaturate and all such things. But Lightroom gives you functionality with, again, a single click of a button. This generally, you can remove the chromatic aberration. So this is again present in your lens corrections. Just above the enable profile correction, we have removed chromatic aberration. Say once you click on it, see, it goes away. So this is again a wonderful thing that you can correct it post in your post-production also. Since these are the glitches caused while shooting and which can be corrected, we have put it under this panel called lens correction. Say Lightroom is still not able to correct your chromatic aberration. So what you have to do is just go to your manual module. Just next to your profile tab, there is something called as manual tab. Just go to the manual tab and take on this picker icon and place it on this whatever chromatic aberration color that you are seeing. So once you pick, once you place your dropper on that particular color, so Lightroom will automatically identify the fringing that has caused and it will give you the correction, best correction. Then you can ideally play with these sliders to change the intensity of that particular color. Ideally, it should go away in this single click of a button, remove chromatic aberration. If this doesn't happen, you can go to this manual for final controls. So this is how chromatic aberration works. Next thing, we have something called as color range mask. Okay, so this is available in your develop module. All these panels that I showed, this is available in your radial filter and adjustment brush. There I have this image. This was shot in Spiti Valley. I have this image unfortunately, say I have forgotten to use my circular polarizing filter. So since I've not used that filter, my sky is flat, for example. Now I have to enhance my sky. So if I want to enhance my sky, what I would do, generally I would apply a brush on it and I would try to get more details on it. But in this case, it is not so simple, right? Because there are clouds also. So if you want to eliminate the clouds, say for example, you take the brush here, and you change the brush size. So the flower bracket right key is to increase the brush size, or left button would be to decrease your brush size. Alternatively, you can also use the slider here to increase and decrease the size. Okay, so now I want to select only the sky, but I don't want to select the clouds. In this case, there is a small tip here. Say when I apply the color, when I apply the brush, there is something called as show selected mask overlay. This means this shows the regions which are being brushed upon. So the regions that are getting affected would be shown by this color. When you click show selected mask overlay, it would show all the regions that are getting affected by the brush. Say now you have applied only on the sky, right? But somehow the other clouds are also selected. Now if you want to underexpose, see, the clouds are also getting affected. So what is the best solution if you just want the sky to be selected? So we have something called as color range mask. Say suppose you take your graduated filter, just apply across the sky. Don't worry about the selection. Just apply across the sky. And there is this thing called as range mask. So this is available, I think, from 9 Lightroom Classic 9.0 version onwards. Mostly it would not be there in your older Lightroom 6 versions and all. So if you want better features, you should keep on upgrading the software. So this is available, as I said, in the recent versions. So once you select your gradual filter, and there is something called as color. So in range,
Arjun, hello Arjun.
Yeah.
Hello Arjun, can you hear me?
Yes.
There is a small audio. Could you just repeat that?
Is it audible now?
Yeah. Now it is clear. Yes.
Yeah. So what I was saying is, say you have this particular, I was saying that this range mask option is available from the recent Lightroom releases, I think from 9. Currently it is 9.2 that is there. I think from 8.3 or 8.4, this should be available mostly. So this particular tool is help you to refine a particular color, which otherwise is very difficult to select. So in this case, I would just want to select the sky. So I apply my graduated filter, take this range mask. Here in range mask dropdown, you have different options, say color. So once you select the color, you get this picker icon again, like how you get it in white balance. Just take the picker icon, just apply across which area you need. So in this case, see, it is only the sky gets selected. So this otherwise is a very difficult thing to achieve in brush and other things. But with just a small selection, you can refine the areas. So then you can again change the intensity based on your amount slider that is available. So once I get my desired results, I will just select, I will leave it, and then probably I can just work on it so that I get my desired effect as I had used my polarizing filter. For example, see to see the before and after, there is this forward slash icon. So if you click that, you can see the before and after. So if you click the slash, see how it was before. And once you click the same button again, you can see the after. So only my sky is selected. So this is again a good thing if you want to refine.
Just hey, I couldn't make out where you selected before and after.
Okay, the forward slash key, right? So just before your delete button, or if you are using Windows, it is before below your backspace button. If you are using a Mac, it is below your delete button. The forward slash key. So that is the thing that you have to select to use before and after. In Windows, it is above Enter and backspace keys. Did you get it?
Yeah, this is...
Was I audible?
Above Enter, you mean?
Yeah, above Enter, you have a small slash key, right? So if you click on that, it shows... It just basically cycles between your before and after versions. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Arjun. Yeah.
Yeah. So this is how you can compare between your before edits and after edits using the backslash icon. So this is how color range mask works out. It works out wonders if you want to select a particular color. Next, I'm going to HSL panel. So HSL, again, so in HSL, you basically change the colors of a particular color. So in this case, the lady in red dress, right? So I want to change the color of red from red to magenta. Say I just go to my hue, below my tone curve, there is a panel called HSL and color pan. So there are wide applications of it, hue, saturation, luminance. This panel basically works only on colors. So how colors are affected, the intensity of colors can be enhanced using this particular section. So in hue section, there are multiple sliders. So say I just want to change the intensity of red in her dress. So if I just negate it, it becomes pink. If I forward it, it becomes orange. So within a small, just a small movement of a slider, you can change the complete color of this particular color. Now there are limitations of using it also. Okay, I'll explain you what is the limitation. But if you are like for a normal purpose, this makes this is the best thing to use. But if at all there are some limitations, you will have to. I'll explain you what we can do. So alternatively, see there are sliders here: red, orange, yellow, green, aqua, blue, purple, magenta. So if you take it to the red slider to the next, if you increase the red, it becomes orange. That means it becomes the next color that is available here. So in orange, if you decrease, that means it becomes red. If you increase, it becomes yellow. So basically, you would know how it works actually. So it just takes the color that is next to it. There is a spectrum, if you can see in the slider. So the left spectrum of orange would be red and the right spectrum of orange would be yellow. So this is how the colors, this is how you can make adjustment to individual colors. And if you want to increase the intensity of a color, say in this case, I want to increase the intensity of red. So I just say my luminance. So all the reds would be brightened up. If you want to make it darker, just reduce the luminance, it will become dark. Okay, so this is the basic use of HSL, how you can play with colors. And saturation, you all know, it brings out pops, it brings a pop in a color.
Arjun, sorry, how did you select the place where you want to make the changes in the hue and the saturation?
Correct. So this particular section is available in develop module. Below the tone curve, there is this HSL color thing. So
that
here
is understood. But in this photograph, how did you select the
exactly
portion?
Exactly. So in this photograph, I've not selected anything. So Lightroom intelligently does select red, whatever slider I'm applying, only that particular slider it affects on.
Okay.
So there is a limitation to this, which I will be explaining now. Say you want to, so this lady has a red dress color, and what if there are some red flowers or a rose bouquet in it? And if you change the red sliders, it would also change the color of the rose. Whatever is there in the image, whatever color that is getting affected in the image, everything is getting affected because of this red color. If at all you don't have any such limitations, you just want to change the color of the dress, red dress here, then it is fine. In this case, majority of it is only red, so it is fine here. I just changed it with the slider. Say in this case, I have this van and I want to change the color of it. So in this case, but there are some red, say I have some oranges that I have to change. On the rooftop, there are oranges. On the rooftop of the bus, there are oranges. And on the rooftop of the house, on the top left, there are oranges. So say if I want to, change the color of orange, it will change everywhere in the image, wherever there are oranges. So this is the limitation of just using HSL slider. Now you will have to use more refined controls, which I'll explain. Earlier, if you remembered, right, before the session, I explained like, what if the image is not there with you right now? Say you are traveling and the image is not there. So the Lightroom doesn't take that image into consideration. So in this case, it is the same. So I had imported the image and somehow the image got deleted or moved to some different location. Now say it says file cannot be found. That means Lightroom knows that this particular image was there, but it is not there currently. So you cannot make any adjustments to it. So how to bring it back? So there is a small missing icon, if you can see on the film strip. So on the top left, top right of the cell, you can see a small exclamation mark. This says that photo is missing currently. Also, you can see here also in the right panel, it says photo is missing. So what you can do is just click on this icon. It says, okay, this photo was there earlier. Now it is not there. If you want to relocate it, click on locate. So it will tell you, it will give you the location where it was earlier. Say in this case, earlier it was in my desktop when I imported. Then after that, I moved it to this folder called LR presentation. Now it is in this folder. So Lightroom doesn't know that this location is changed. So now what you need to do, you have to explicitly tell Lightroom to use this new location and do not use the older location. So what Lightroom would do, it will locate, it will relink the new location and it will allow your image to work as it is. Say I have selected the image now. In a while it will get applied. See, all the controls are available now. So this is how you would have to relocate your missing images, right? Okay, now I got this image back. Now say I have applied my colors. So the previous limitation was if there is a particular color, you can change it only using HSL. However, if there are multiple colors of the same color that is intended to be changed, and HSL does not suffice because it will change every other color that is there in the image. So in this case, see if you can see, I'm changing my reds here on the bus. but my rooftop is also being changed, right? So what I have to do is I will have to, in this case, I will have to make a selection only for the red area. So as I explained earlier, what we can use, we can make use of the color range adjustment that I had demonstrated earlier, right? So one thing here would be, whenever you select a brush icon and when you apply, initially you get it in red color, and the overlay color would be red, okay? So in this case, my bus is also in red color. So say I apply my filter, I apply my brush here, but I cannot make out which are the areas that are selected because my background color is also red. So what you can do is, I'm just removing the other areas that are not worthy enough to keep. So I have brushed upon the red bus, but I don't know if my selection is perfect or not. So what you can do is, first thing to show the selection is to use the mask overlay. That is what is there below. You just click on it, it shows the mask overlay. Alternative key is to press O, shortcut key is O. If you press O, it will show the overlay. Say in this case, my bus is red color and my applied mask color is also red. So what you can do is hold shift and O, it changes the mask color. So here, there are different colors that you can select. One is red, green, white and black. So in this case, green looks good to me. So I'll just keep it as green. This is just the mask color. It is not the applied color. So keep this in mind. Mask color meaning it affects only the regions that are present in this green color. It does not mean that I have painted this red bus with green color. Okay. Say I have just applied the correction, and you can just go to color what I showed earlier, range mask, and just click on red. Only this thing gets applied. So now you can ideally change the color. You can ideally remove the saturation or increase it, or you can do whatever needed on the image. Say if it is undersaturated or oversaturated, it becomes like this. Now, in the HSL panel spectrum, say for red, I had only this particular region. So I could either go only from pink to orange. If I want a red bus to be changed to a blue bus, I could not do in this HSL panel, right? So in this case, there are two options here. One is you can create a camera profile out of it. So there are variety of camera profiles, tutorials that are available online. So there you can create a source color and a destination color. You can give this mapping where red becomes blue, green becomes black or whatever. So that you can apply. So
Arjun, sorry to Hello, Arjun.
Yes.
Arjun.
Yeah. Hello.
Yeah. Sorry to interrupt. There is one question from Ritesh.
Okay.
From Ritesh. How do we change the mask color? Could you repeat the keys, please?
Yeah, changing the mask color would be to hold shift and O. Shift key and the O key. So if you hold shift and O, just O will either enable or disable the overlay. Shift and O will change the mask color.
Okay. Thank you, Arjun.
Yeah. So what I was telling is, say in this HSL panel, you can only change the color spectrum of red slider just from magenta to orange, but you cannot change it to any other color. So you have two options now. Either you create a camera profile out of it, or there is something called as a color option. Say you have applied the brush here, and there is this color option which is present below your edits under your brush, whatever brush you have selected, either be it gradient or radial or brush. Say go to this color and say I want it to be blue now. Okay. So now it becomes blue, but you can still see there are some slight tinges of oranges. I just wanted to show you the idea of how it can be made. It is like not like making it perfect selection. So you can, to further intensify the colors, you can click on duplicate so that all those areas would be selected. So if you make refine adjustments, right? So you can just select these particular areas, you can change the colors of it. So whichever was not possible in HSL spectrum for red color, that can be made, that can be changed using this color. Hello, yeah.
Sorry for interrupting. How to remove mask in unwanted areas?
Yeah, I'll come to that. I'll explain you.
Okay.
Let me show you that example only. Say in this example, I have selected the mask. Say I have, I want to select this person here. I wanted to select only this person. However, as you can see my mask, right? So it is the red regions are the other areas that are selected and I don't want these areas. So with the brush selected, hold the option key in Mac or Alt key in Windows. If you hold that key, you can see this plus, whatever in the icon, there is plus. Plus means to add your mask. Minus means to remove the mask. So if you hold your Alt or Option key, this icon changes to minus. So minus means it is ready to remove the mask. So while holding your Alt or Option key, just apply on the areas that are not needed. So this will remove the regions that are unwanted. Unwanted regions are removed. So the option, the thing is to use Alt or Option key and just hold and just brush up on the unwanted areas. So in this case, the unwanted areas is removed. Did this answer?
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, as I said, if you want to change the colors, then try out this option also, which is available here. Color option, you can change from any spectrum to any other spectrum. Okay. So then let me, HSL is done, lens correction is done. Okay, let me go to panoramas. So there is a good feature in Lightroom where you can merge images. So there are things called as merging images where you can merge to panoramas or HDRs or HDR panoramas. So earlier what used to happen was there are many set of landscape photographers who wanted details in every region, every tonal region of the image, be it from total white, total bright to total dark. So they used to shot multiple sets of multiple brackets of HDR images and sequence it in a panorama and then merge it to HDRs individually, then again merge those to panoramas. But in Lightroom, we have a feature to directly merge to HDR panorama. We have a feature to directly merge to only panoramas and we have feature to directly merge only to HDR images. So these are the images that I've shot individually and this would take some amount of time, but I will just show you the briefing of it. So when you say control and M is the shortcut key to merge to a panorama. Alternatively, you can right click on the selected, you can select all images, right click on it. So there is this photo merge option that you can see. In photo merge, you can select whichever option is needed, HDR panorama or HDR panorama. Say in this case, you do a panorama. So once you do a panorama, Lightroom aligns all those images, then you can merge it to panorama. This will take some amount of time because all are raw images and in high intensity. So I have a different set, so which I can show you. Say this is also the same set of images which I'm merging to panorama. So this is how the basic panorama structure looks, right? So this is because say you would have not shot the image or you would have not shot the image in a sequence or there would be some areas that are not merged properly while shooting. So if Lightroom is not able to align properly, you can see such white areas. Now how to correct these white areas? We have three options for this again. So one is to use auto crop. So what auto crop does is it'll remove the cropped areas and it'll only just it'll remove the white areas and crop accordingly. It'll remove the white areas and crop accordingly. Say in this case, if you can see just above the sun, there is this big white spot, right? So, and so that's the reason auto crop would crop only from this portion. It will just slightly include the sun. If you click auto crop, see the sun is only a small portion of the sun is included. Now there are, this is auto crop. Now there is another option where, which will scale the image accordingly. It will remove all the white areas by scaling your image. So this is called as boundary warp. It is like it's stretching the image basically. See, once you click start start moving the slider of boundary warp, it will start stretching your images. See how the sun became, how the bridge became and the horizon, it all started to curve because it started to stretch the image. Okay. So this is one image. So there are different examples. I think in some cases boundary warp would look good. In some cases auto crop would look good. So all these things. So it is not like you will have to use auto crop only or boundary warp, but you can use any of these things. So there is a third thing called as fill edges that is recently introduced. I think in 9.2 Lightroom Classic 9.1. I think Lightroom Classic 9.1. So what it does is you would be aware of the content aware technology that Photoshop uses, right? So it automatically detects the area and fills those area. So we have this fill edges option that is there in Lightroom. So if you click on fill edges, what happens is Lightroom automatically understands what area would be there next to it and it fills it magically there. So there are researches that is going on, like how the area gets calculated and how the content has to be applied. So you can use this option also. So based on content aware, it just analyzes the area that has to be ideally placed in this fill, white places, and it will just fill with that area. See, in this case, the dark white regions, whatever was there below, it knew that it has to fill with darker regions here. It knew it has to fill with sky and clouds here. So it does it automatically. So this is also another way of using these tools to enhance your images. So there are three ways to stitch your image, three different things that you can use to stitch your images. One would be the fill edges, one would be boundary warp, and one would be your auto crop. So this is all about panorama. So if you want to merge for HDR, again, there is like you select images, do a control H. Control H is the shortcut key for HDR. So, or go to photo merge and HDR. So either key would be fine. So control H or photo merge and HDR. So same thing happens and it stitches to HDR. Right. So this is another use of stitching, how you can stitch images. So if you are, as I said earlier, if you are really unsure about the keyboard shortcuts, you can go to help menu, and if you use this shortcut key, it gives you a list of all the shortcuts available in this particular module, so you can make use of it. Okay, the next another feature that we can see is the spot removal tool that I showed you earlier. So the shortcut key, this is there next to the crop icon in the develop module. Shortcut key would be Q. Use the shortcut key for it, or you can click the second icon, the round icon. This is the shortcut key. Say I have this image of a spider, and because of some bad maintenance of the camera, there are some dust spots in my lens. Now, visually, what I can see few 4 or 5 dust spots that I can manually correct. So this is a very good example of never to believe your eye. Say your eye assumes only there are few spots and you have corrected it. Okay. Now you think everything is fine and you go and print it on and you get it printed. And once you get it printed on large scale, you identify there are like lot many more spots that had to be corrected before processing it. So in Lightroom, we have the spot removal tool with the advanced option called as visualize spots that is there down below. Just above the film strip, there is something called as visualize spots. So if you click on it, it identifies how many spots are there in the image. See, with just a single click, it does a magic here. You can basically see a galaxy of stars only in the image. So these are the various dust spots that were there in my image. And this I could have never seen with my eye. I would have just removed 3-4 spots, the predominant spots that was seen, but the all the underlying spots was not seen through the naked eye. So there is this option called visualize spots. So what you have to do is select the spot removal tool, click on visualize spots that is there below, below the image. So if you click on it, it becomes like this. So then you know which are the spots that are available. Then you can just apply. You can just, you know, click on the spot so that those are removed. Okay, so these are the different things that you can use in Lightroom. And local adjustments are like of a very good help actually. Say for example, in this image, you do fashion photography and people ask you to remove pimples or all these blemishes on their skin. So pimples you can easily remove using the spot removal tool. But say, unfortunately, if somebody had a yellow tooth and yellow teeth and you had to remove it. So basically in post-processing, you can do it very easily. So we have presets for it. So you just select the area, right? So in this effect, next to effect, there is this wide range of presets that are there. So you can just select the teeth whitening option that is there. So what it does is it removes the yellowness in the teeth and it gives you white. See, it was like this before and it is like this now, right? So this is basically how you use local adjustments. Now there are more, there are other options like presets and presets, history tools and all these things, which I will explain you. Say I want, okay, I have edited this image. There are individual, I mean, there are similar set of images that I have. Okay, I wanted to say I have edited one image and I wanted it to make it look like a sunset. I wanted to give it a sunset feel. Okay. Just an example, I'm sure. Say I have done all these adjustments and I want to replicate the same on the other image also. So it's not like you need to go and do all the edits from scratch on the other image. So what you can do is there is something called as presets. So preset is nothing but a predefined set of instructions that you give to the computer, which will replicate whatever you have told it to do. Say in this case, I have just touched only the basic sliders. Whatever is there here, I have just touched only these sliders. So based on this, let me create a preset. So preset is available in the develop module. Left panel, you get this preset preset heading. So next to that, there is a small plus icon. So if you click on that, you get these options to create preset. So click on create preset. It will ask what all settings I have to include in my preset. Say you, in this case, you have just used your white balance because I've changed a bit of temperature and you have just made some basic panel adjustments. So click on basic tool. So since I've done only these many adjustments, let me call it as my sunset preset, for example. So you select only these things and create a preset out of it. So once you create a preset out of it, it is visible in your user preset section, my sunset preset. Say you go to this image and you need not apply the same setting again and again, which you had applied here. You can just click on this preset. So basically it will give you, okay, this I did not have my presence here. Probably I can update that as well. Let me do this color sections also. Okay, this is updated now. So when you click on it, see, it applies my saturation also. So it, you need not do the same setting again and again. You just
hello, Arjun. Yes, Arjun, yes. Can you hear me? There was small interruption over there. Could you just repeat that, please?
Okay, what I was telling is, say you have edited an image and you want to replicate the same setting on the other set of images also. So it's in Photoshop, what happens is generally you open one image, you make edits and you come out of it, but you don't have that option saved anywhere so that you cannot apply it. For example, in Lightroom, what there is a very good way where you can do this, right? So one thing is you make edits from one image and there is something called as a preset. So you just go to the preset panel, click on create presets. So you select all the options that is required to you and create a preset out of it, right? You create a preset out of it and say you want to apply it to the next image. So this I'd already applied. So if you want to reset all the settings that you have done on an image, click on the reset button here. It will reset to as it was. Then go to your preset thing. Just click on the preset, whatever was created. So if you click on it, see, it just replicated almost the same settings that was there, that was created in your preset. So this is how you can work with presets. It's a very good way to use presets to to avoid all the hassles of recreating those sliders again and again. Next thing is, multiple images, right? I have multiple images with the same scene. I have almost the same scene. I have multiple images shot from the same area. So in this case, there is one other advantage of using Lightroom here. So you go to develop module. This image, I will edit to my heart's content. Whatever is possible, I will do it. Just for example, I'm just moving a few sliders. Right. So whatever is needed, I do all edit settings. Now, what if there are hundreds of images of the same scene? So this would usually happen for people who shoot time lapses. So for time lapse, you need to shoot the same scene in multiple sequence intervals of time, but your edit should remain the same if you want to create a time lapse video out of it. So if you have thousand or hundreds of thousands of images, and it's a very laborious task to edit each one of them. So either, as I told, you can apply presets, or if you have, or there is another easy option, what you can do is, say you select all the images, right? So you select all the images. There is something called as auto sync option, right? So if you select auto sync option, just make any adjustments. See, all the images get applied. All the images get the same setting that is created. So you need not go and individually edit each and every image. You can directly select all the images and apply a single slider, and it will affect all the images. So there are again three options to do this. One is through auto sync. Okay. One is auto sync that is there in the develop module. So if you are seeing only one, this auto sync would be enabled if you have selected more than one image. And there is another option called sync. See, if at all you are seeing sync here, it means it affects only the currently active image. If you are seeing auto sync here, it will affect all the images. Say you have selected only one image and now I am in sync mode. It is sync means synchronize. So I am in synchronize and say I want to make it look arranged for all the images. So what I do is I select all. So the first thing that you can do is auto sync. And if auto sync is not the thing for you, you can select all the images and use synchronize module. So if you click on synchronize, it asks what all things I have to synchronize. So it will take from the first image and it will apply on rest of the images. So in this case, I have just increased my temperature. So just say white balance and click synchronize. So what it does is it will apply on all the images. So this is another thing that you can do. There is third thing that you can do, which is called as let me reset all the images. Okay. There is a third thing that you can do that is called as copy paste. So you can directly copy paste a setting from one image to other image. Say, let me say, okay, this time to have some change, let me make it blue completely. And if I want to apply it on every image, right? Say copy. Now in this case, again, I'm on, I have selected white balance since that's the only thing. For the next image and say paste. See, it pastes on everything. So if your auto sync is on and say paste, it will paste on everything. So if it is on sync mode and if you say paste, it will apply only on that image. And if it is in auto sync and if you click on paste, it will apply on all the images. So this is a very good thing if you want to use it in your time lapse videos. So these are the different, actually, if you, like, there are many features and it take like lots of time to explain everything, but just giving a gist of all possible things of Lightroom. One more thing, as which I told earlier, like Lightroom is non-destructive, right? So what I meant to say was non-destructive was, say I have one image, I have this image selected. In Photoshop, suppose you open this image and make multiple edits, say you made hundreds of edits, and now if you want to go back to the 50th edit or the 30th edit, there is no option for you to go back. How many control Zs you do, how many undos you do, it will, after some point, it will stop. But in Lightroom, we don't affect the image. So image, there is underlying image, raw image as a whole, we don't affect it at all. We put on layers on top of it. Layers, what you call in Photoshop, is called as history in this, in Lightroom. So we don't affect the original image at all. And we just keep on changing layers. It is like as good as a human body. So we keep on putting dress on top of us, right? So at any point of time, if you want to change, you can just change. Whereas your body remains intact. So same thing in Lightroom also. Your original image remains intact at any point of time. Say in this case, see, I had made all these... I make all these edits, whatever edits I want, I make all the edits. Now at any point of time, I want to go back to any edit, I can just go to history and select a particular value, whatever thing that was needed. So it will basically go to that setting and you can edit from there onwards. Or if say you want a black and white image out of it. So just say, click on black and white, which is there next to the treatment, color, whatever color tab, click on black and white, it becomes black and white. Or shortcut key would be V. So if you press V, it changes the colors from black and white to color and color to black and white. Say, click on V. Now you have all these histories, right? So from this point, say you want a separate image and I want separate images for the rest of my image. You keep on changing your edits, edits keep on adding in your history. Now you want to go back to your edit where you made it black and white. So you click on black and white. You got this image. You can start working on it separately. Or what you can do, there is a thing called virtual copy that is there in Lightroom. So you can right click on the image and click on create virtual copy. So what virtual copy does is it just replicates your image, whatever image you had with the setting that you had. Say in history, I had created from that black and white position, I created a virtual copy. Virtual copy doesn't take any space in your hard disk. It is just a logical referencing of your physical image. How do you identify if it's a virtual copy or not is, on the image, if you see the image, there is a small triangle on top of it. In the bottom left on your film strip, this indicates this image is a film strip. So then you can make any adjustments to this without changing the master copy. In master, you can retain, say master copy, I wanted my color version to remain intact and black and white to remain intact in my virtual copy. So you can do such things also. So you can have all these different tools where you can edit your images without altering the image actually. So you can just go to history and from any point of time you can create or you can add layers on top of it. Then the next thing would be so these are the different some nice features that we saw in Lightroom. So let me show you what else we can do in Lightroom. So there is something called as mobile, Lightroom Mobile Sync. So as I showed you in the first slide, where I told you we have different Lightroom clients like Lightroom Mobile Client and Lightroom Desktop Client. And there is a way to interact with all these things, right? So this is the thing that I was telling about. So there is something called as Lightroom Mobile Sync. So this sync should not be mistaken with the synchronized thing that I showed you in develop module where you can apply the same setting to all the images. That sync is different and this sync is different. This sync is like you're syncing your images from your local machine to the cloud. Okay, so where this comes into use right? So in I'll show you my Lightroom. Say you are traveling, you are on the go, and you don't have a Lightroom catalog with you. You don't have your physical desktop machine with you. So what I do is I put all my images when I am at home. I put all my images in this collection, and I mark it to sync. So there is a small box icon here. So if you click on that box icon, this icon changes to the small arrow kind of thing, right? As you can see, my next to this collection called Test Sync. So this means that this particular collection is synced with the cloud. If this is synced with the cloud, wherever you are in the world, you can see this image, even if you don't have your desktop or Lightroom catalog with you. Say I have my Lightroom mobile and this gets downloaded to your mobile. So let me show you an example. Say I have already synced this image. Now it is in my, I told you earlier about Lightroom web, right? So if you just hit this URL, this is the Lightroom web application that opens, and you will have to sign in with your ID. Say I have opened this image. So I have, this is the downloaded image, whatever I had synced from my Lightroom Classic catalog. Say suppose you make some adjustments to it. So you make some adjustments to it. Since it is in a synced collection, it starts syncing. So it says syncing one photo is uploading to the cloud. So if it is uploaded, what that means is it is also reflecting here. So the same thing, whatever you see in my whatever you see in the Google Chrome application, Lightroom web, I have hit the URL here. So it basically syncs the image from my Lightroom classic catalog to my Lightroom web application. So wherever in the world you are with your mobile phones, and if you have your Lightroom application, you can get this image. On the vice versa, you can upload images from your Lightroom mobile application also. And once you come back home, in your Lightroom Classic catalog, all those images would have been downloaded, right? So that is how it happens. See, I had made changes to my image in my Lightroom Classic catalog, and it is getting reflected here. So where does this come into use? So one use case is like, whenever you are moving out of town, you can make, you can sync and you can use it on your phones. And second thing is, say you are a wedding photographer and you want to give images to your clients. Say you have hundreds of images and you want to give it to your clients. And you make edits and you take it through a pen drive and give it to him, and he sees and he's not happy and he'll ask you to make some more changes. And this process keeps on happening. It keeps on happening. So what you do is an easy way is you just put all these images into this collection, just sync it. Once you sync it, there is this Lightroom links. When you right click on the collection, you get something called as Lightroom links. Here you make this collection as public. So once you make it public, you get a link. Actually, you get some link. So if you give this link to the client, no matter if he has Lightroom or not, he can open the, he can see all the images that are synced. So he'll give this data set to you. You will have this image. He will be able to see this image. Now then he can make comments on like if this is good or not good, make this slightly, make this black and white or change exposure. Then you can make the change immediately and you can give it to him. So the process of traveling to his place and getting things and this big hassle is avoided. So this is also one good application that can be used through Lightroom Sync. Other thing that you can use Lightroom for is you can create time-lapse images. You can also, it's not like from Lightroom, only in Lightroom you'll have to edit images. Say you have edited image and you really need the necessity to take it to Photoshop to make it further refined adjustment. So right click on the image, you get this editing toolbar where you can select the applications where you can go and we can take it to edit the image in a different software through Lightroom. Next thing is you can also create time-lapse videos from Lightroom itself. Say it looks like this actually. You can create time-lapse videos in Lightroom. So all the images that I showed earlier, right? So you can make edit on one image, select all the images, because this particular video has, I think, around 700 images. So select all the images, make edits, whatever you want. Then in Lightroom slideshow module, you can export the video to a time lapse. So you have imported them, you have organized them, now you have developed them also. So the last thing would be to export your images. So exporting, so am I on?
Yes, there was a small break, Arjun. I think. Sorry, now you're not audible. Arjun, you're not audible.
Workflow would be, so I think I'll repeat again. I don't know if my internet was stable. So the workflow that we saw till now was like how you could capture the image, how you could import them, how you could organize them, how you could develop them. Now the last thing would be to export your images, put it to your all the social medias, or export it in your system. So all these things can be done by export images. So in Lightroom, when you go to Lightroom, right? So in Lightroom, there is a option called as export next to my import section in the library module. So if you click on export, it will ask you to where to export, what should be the file name, what should be the image size. You can limit your image sizes also. Longer edge if you want this particular file length and dimensions and all such things. You can also add your watermarks in Lightroom. So there is this thing called as watermark. Say you edit your watermark, you can name whatever you want. In this case, let it be as it is. And you can also place it wherever you want in the image. So now it is in bottom left, bottom right, all these places, wherever you want, you can create a watermark and save. Say my watermark, I create this watermark and save and I export it. So it will be exported to my desktop. So it will be exported to my desktop. Let me show you. So this is the fundamentals of using Lightroom, basically, from the basic workflow to the export workflow. All you can do through Lightroom. So this is all of it actually. Let me show you the exported image. So can you see my screen now? I think, see, this is how my exported image looks like. So with the watermark. So this is how you can export images to any particular folder, or you can, if you have plugins here. So there are plugins that you can see here. So you can ideally publish from Lightroom to Stock or Facebook or Flickr or whatever. So directly you just put it in that catalog, and when you say publish, it will directly publish to all the whatever selected social media. So this is, I think, all about it. Actually, like to explain Lightroom, it takes a lot of time. There are so many modules and so many functions. But yeah, so I've just explained the basic organizing and editing images. But you have a lot of tutorials available online that you can try out, and you can see like about various modules, how to use others as well, how to print and slideshows and all such things. So yes, this is all about it. Thank you
Arjun for this wonderful session. Now yeah, I would like to we would like to go ahead with the question and answers. So yes, please proceed. Yes,
yeah, Arjun, hi, this is Ravi Satyamurthy. I had a basic question. I could see that in your version of, or in your Lightroom, you have your name edited right next to the logo. It's a basic question that I'm asking. Is there a way that I could change that also to my name?
Yes, you can do. I'll just show my Lightroom Classic catalog. Okay, so this one, right?
Hello, Arjun. I am Sanjay.
One second. So I'll just answer the previous question. You are talking about this one, right? So what is the
next? No. In your Lightroom.
Okay.
You have your name. Not on the photograph, but on the Lightroom app itself or software itself.
Right. So this is called as the identity plate. So ideally, if you have signed in with your ID, it shows up here. Or what you can do is go to your Lightroom Classic identity plate setup option. So here you can change your ID, whatever ID. You can give your personalized ID also, or you can give a graphic logo. Whatever name you want, you can change here. Say, let me make it, see if I change, it will become Honeycomb, for example. So this is what you were asking, is it?
No. I think not on the slideshows or anything that you are showing. I'm talking of in the software itself, the Lightroom software itself. There is your name. Is it licensed to your name, or is it that I can also? So I have a legal version of Lightroom. So can I change that to my name to be shown on the screen?
Is it possible for you to draw on the screen, like which one you are referencing to? I'm not able to.
I don't see that screen here. I mean, if you can open your Lightroom, maybe I can.
I have opened Lightroom Classic catalog itself. Is my Lightroom? Can it be seen?
Yeah, now yes. I can see it.
Okay, you're talking about the top left one, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. So, okay, I was actually explaining that, but somehow my screen was not sharing. So, what you can do is you can click on this Lightroom Classic menu item. So, there is something called as Identity Plate Setup.
Okay.
So, once you click on Identity Plate Setup, you can have whatever option that can be shown. So, click on Personalized here in the drop-down. So you can change whatever name. So in this case, if I want to change it to Honeycomb, I'll just type Honeycomb and it will be shown there. So you can do anything. Or if you have a personalized logo, PNG logo with you, you can also put that as well. There is this option called Use a Graphical Identity Plate, and you can just upload it and it will be selected there.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much.
Hello, Arjun. I'm Sanjay. I like to know that we are talking about the DSLR camera or cellular camera to connect with Lightroom. Can we use the mobile camera to connect with Lightroom and edit the pics?
Mobile itself has Lightroom application actually. So you can directly import photos from your mobile to Lightroom application.
Okay.
So you can directly use that thing. But if at all you want to use it in Lightroom Classic catalog, ideally you can import it through the SD card or whatever is there in your phone. Or you can do the second thing was you can take photos from your Lightroom. You can take photos from your mobile. Then in Lightroom, you can import them so that it will be synced to the cloud. So once you open your Lightroom Classic at your home, all those photos would be synced down. Then you can start editing on it.
And my second question is, you are talking about the presets. I think that it is very much similar what we do in Photoshop, like creating action and then doing batch processing to lot number of files.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
So those are actions, and this thing contains like individual, you can ideally put it to all images during your import itself, all those things. Actually in Photoshop on one particular image, you'll do all those actions and then you do batch processing. Here you can, at the start only you can apply the preset. So initially only you'll get to know how it looks like on all the images.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah.
Arjun, there's a question from Mr. Srinivas. Okay. He wants to know, like, how can we create user-defined brush presets?
User-defined brush presets. You mean the developed presets, or you mean the brushes?
Mr. Srinivas, could you just speak to Mr. Arjun on this?
Okay, I think by preset, I think he meant to say what I'm showing in my screen here. Whatever settings, say you apply any setting, whatever setting you want to the image, and there in the preset panel, next to the preset panel, there is, firstly, you have to be in develop module, then start edit your images. Then on the left side, left panel, go to the presets, and next to it, there is a plus icon. click on the plus icon, it will show to create presets or import presets and all such things. So you create preset, check values, whatever you have, all the values, and you click on create so that preset is created. Now, there are many people who actually sell presets. So they have their own style of images. They have their own style of editing. They have presets of their own. So they sell their images. So in such case, if you get such preset, what you can do is you click on the plus icon and click on import presets. So this way you can import those presets and you can use it on your images also. Did this answer the question?
Yes, yes. Thank you. Thank you, Arjun.
Yeah.
Yeah. Any more questions? You can please ask.
One last question. You did, Arjun, sorry. You did show us the spot removal tool. Is it possible that you can also use the masking to remove the tool? I mean, remove the spots?
Masking in the sense? The brushes, is it?
Yes.
No. That won't be possible. You can do it from spot removal tool only. Brushes, it just intensifies the area, actually. If you want to make the spot look more visible, then you can use the brush tool. If you want to remove the spot, you'll have to use the spot removal tool.
Okay. Now, if we are using a masking and mask thing, if it is towards the darker side, will the spots be hidden?
It'll look like a patch. Say, you can see my screen. Na? Let me show you.
Yeah, I can see it now. Yeah.
Okay. Wait. I'll show you. I have my brush tool and say I've selected this spot. So if I make it under, see, it'll look like a patch actually.
Yeah, black spot.
Black spot. So take the spot removal tool and just click on this. It'll go away. You can select whichever area you want. So that particular area, it'll select and from there, it'll copy. It's same like your Photoshop.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. So, and what I would like to say is editing is always a personal preference, and there is no hard and fast rule that you will have to use only these sliders to get the desired effect. You can use any sliders it's basically your personal preference. But only thing is overdoing it would somehow look like this actually. So this is your original image and this is the edited image. And if you want to make it extremely edited, so it will somehow look like the totally right side image. So it's all up to you actually how you want to show. So there is no hard and fast rule that it should somehow be shown in a particular way. So this is all about it. Yeah. Any more questions? I think you can probably, if you have any questions, you can email me as well. This is my email ID. So you can email me any questions if you have. I'll be happy to explain. Thanks a lot. Thanks to Honeycomb and all of you. Any more questions you have?
Thank you so much, Arjun. Very informative.
Hello. I think Raja wanted to ask some question. He raised a hand.
Okay.
Any workflow? He wanted to know any workflow on.
You want to know the workflow from starting to end, is it?
Yeah, that. Yes. Okay. For processing. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Sure. Let me show that. You can see my Lightroom Classic catalog, no?
Yes.
Okay. Let me take one image so you can so this is my Lightroom Classic catalog. So the first thing would be to import images, as I told earlier. So click on import. So once import window opens, it asks from where you want to import and where you have to place it. And there are three options here. As you can see on the top, there is copy as DNG, there is copy, move, and add. So generally click on add option. If you do a copy or copy as DNG, what will happen is there will be two copies stored. One would be there in your whatever location, hard disk location, and one would be in your physical laptop also. So there would be two copies. If that is your intended behavior, then it is fine. You can have two copies. But if you want only one copy, then click on the add button here. So in here, I can here this shows the source place from where I can import my images. So select your location from where you want to import the image. So in this case, I have some images in my Lightroom presentation folder. So by default, all the images would be checked. If it is checked, that means these images are ready to be imported. So you can also click on uncheck all. That means it will remove all the images from selection, and you can click any image, any particular image that you want to be, that you want to get it imported. So in this case, let me take this image where I want to import. I'll just click on the checkbox icon. So if I click the checkbox icon, the import button is now enabled. So that means it is getting ready to be imported. So here, while importing itself, I can have some options that I can do it to the image. One is like you can directly add it to whichever collection that you have created, or you can after import also you can go and put it in the collection. Or say suppose you have, you can directly while importing itself, you can apply a preset. Say for example, I created the sunset preset that I had created a while back. So in this case, let me, I mean, this is also, if at all you want, you can create, or you, if you want, you can apply the preset, or if you don't want, you can just put it as new. So in this case, if you want, if I want to retain the preset, I'll just click on sunset and say import. So this shows this particular image out of 687 photos, this particular photo, one photo, whatever you are seeing here, one photo, which is of 25 MB from this location, the Lightroom desktop LR presentation location is getting imported. So this is all the basic information that it tells about. Now click on import. So it basically comes and imports, gets imported here, right? So it gets imported. Now, as I have applied my sunset preset, see, I have, you can see it is already applied. The sunset preset is already applied because I had selected it during the time of import. Now, if you don't want, you just click on reset it so that everything goes away. Now, in this case, there is an image of a greenling spider that I'd shot a long while back. So say, I am happy with the vertical portrait orientation of this image. So I just crop it. So when I go to visualize spots, when I go to my spot removal, I can see some spot here. So I'll just remove it using my visualize spot key. So this is removed. Now, then the editing totally depends on how you want to take it forward. So see, in this case, let me zoom a bit more. If you hold the space bar, you get the hand symbol where you can drag it wherever you want. Okay. Now say in this case, this was the image. Because of the backlighting and the overexposed regions, the regions on the legs of the spider, I cannot see any details. So what I do is I generally reduce the highlights so I can see the details of all the highlight regions. See, you can see the translucent legs of it. Then probably you can slightly play with your shadows, slight whites and blacks. That's it. So if you are really into popping out colors, such stuff, you can play with your saturation, vibrance, et cetera. Tone curve, if you want extended, extensive editing, more highlight controls, more shadow controls, you can play with your tone curve also. Then like if you are totally happy with it, just increase the sharpness a bit. I just hold a mask key, which I told earlier, because I want only my spider and the plant to be sharpened. There is also, you can apply noise reduction. It will remove the noise. See here. You see how it was before? how it was before, and if you apply noise reduction, see, it will go off totally. But one disadvantage of using this global noise reduction is, see, it removes the noise on the subject also, which you don't want. So in this case, what you have to do is take the radial filter. I explained to you about the invert processing, right? So just apply it on the spider, then invert it. Only the background is selected. Now reduce the noise. Plus noise means it will reduce. So this is one way of doing it. Or another way is you take it to Photoshop, then select only this area, invert it, and you can remove there also. So once this is all done, I will just come back, and if there is like any distortion that I don't like, I'll apply my lens correction and chromatic aberration. Generally, I do remove chromatic aberration because many of the cases I've seen chromatic aberration. So I generally blindly I remove it while importing it all. And I don't do transform unless it is really required. So transform is basically the scaling of your image, how you want to stretch and all those things like rotating and all these stuffs. So these things you can do in transform. Then slight vignetting, if you want, you can use. Vignetting is like it adds a black dark area. If at all you take it to the left, it adds the dark area around the borders of the image. If you take it to the right side, it adds white areas. So many portrait photographers generally use this to print it. So yeah, that's it. Once it is done, and see, it was, I mean, I'll see the before after comparison, and if I like it, I export it. So this is how we can, this is a basic workflow of what I generally do with my images. And one more thing that I wanted to tell was, say, because of your, because the way you have shot the image, or some, if there are architectures in your image which are tilted, right? So you can use the transform tool. So there is something called as guided. So click on guided and you can draw lines on wherever it is tilted. So if you see in this case, the door tends towards, like, it looks, it is tilted behind. So if you apply it generally, like, you know, from see how it is tilted to it becomes straight. So you can correct your perspective corrections also in using these tools. Yeah, then after all these edits, I'll export it and, share it on all social media. That's it.
Arjun?
Yeah.
Is there any way you can just select a subject, especially when you're doing your wildlife photography, you have a lot of background and other this thing. Is there, if you want to just do edit on the subject, can you just select the subject?
Correct. So in this case, say I have my image here. So there is this brush here, right? So you just take the brush and you can apply it gently on the image. So in this case, you can, select only the subject and not the background. So a suggestion that I would like to give is, there is something called as auto mask. If you use it, right, so I'll show you what happens with and without. Say I have not used auto mask. So there is this auto mask when you, it will be activated when this brush is selected. Say now I have selected the image. So as you can see, even the outer areas are also getting selected. So what happens if you use auto mask? It will take the range only in that area. See, only the area is getting selected. See, even though my brush has some outer portions also, it somehow tries to negate that. Then once you get your refined adjustments, then I think you can play with your controls. So basically the tool, tool to only select the subject would be your adjustment brush.
Okay, thank you.
Any more questions, please? I think, Arjun, I think all of them have, you have cleared the doubts of all of them.
Sure. Thank you.
Yeah, so we can wind off this session. Thank you so much, Arjun, for this wonderful session. And we have learned quite a lot about Lightroom. Sure. Thank you, all
Thanks.
Participants.
Thanks
thank you for. Thank you. Thank you, Arjun.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Arjun.
Thank you. If you have any questions, you can mail me. I'll help you.
Sure.
Thank you so much. Where is your mail ID?
I had and I'll just show it on the screen now. Let me show it on the screen. Okay. This is my email ID. So it's arjunharit16@gmail.com.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Arjun. Thank you for attending this.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Arjun.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.